Hi everyone, this is Alicia Katz-Pollock from Royalwise.com, and you can find us online at learn.royalwise.com. And today I'm excited to show you one of my favorite features in my column called Look What I Found, and it's the new Overview tab that shows up in QuickBooks Online for accountants or in QuickBooks Online Advanced. So if you're just a regular business user, you're not going to see this tool, but know that your bookkeeper does have it and is using it behind the scenes. But for all you bookkeepers, this has become one of my go-to tools that I use on a regular basis. So I want to show you how it works. Let me go ahead and share with you my screen. And what we're looking at right now is my sample company, Wild Style Construction. So don't worry, you're not seeing any sensitive data here. But what I want to point out to you is up in the upper right-hand corner, there is a tool called Overview. And so up here, let me go ahead and zoom in on it. There's a tab that says Overview. And again, you're only going to see this if you're using QuickBooks Online for accountants or QuickBooks Online Advanced. This screen gives you a summary of everything that's happening in the file. So if you are either trying to figure out the health of the file to see some of the high points for what's wrong with it that you might need to troubleshoot and fix, or if you are taking a look at a file because you're going to take this person on as a client, it gives you an idea of the scope of the engagement so that when you write your engagement letter or price your services, you know kind of the scale of how much work you're going to have to do. So let's take it from the top. The first of the sections is the company setup, and this is a handy dandy little summary of what's happening in the company. You can see what subscription they have, whether or not they're running QuickBooks payroll. It's not saying that they don't have payroll, it's just, are they using the QuickBooks payroll? You know, maybe they've got Paychex or Gusto or ADP. And whether or not their sales tax is enabled or not. And then you'll also see if they have any apps that are connected to it, which is going to tell you one of two things. Either it's going to tell you that this is a complex company that has a lot of arms out into different third-party apps that you're going to manage, or it might tell you, oh my God, they have automated so much stuff, this is going to be a breeze. So the number of apps, which apps they are going to tell you a lot about the workflow of the company. Then when you scroll down, you've got a section for banking activity. This has all of the different balance sheet accounts, and it shows you their bank balance as of the last time that somebody clicked update. So if nobody's been to the banking center and nobody has clicked update for any time recently, this bank balance is not going to be accurate. But if they did it an hour ago, then it's going to be dead on accurate. You can see the difference between the bank balance and what QuickBooks says that it has. And so if those numbers are pretty close together, you know that they're keeping up with their bank feed and they're doing things fairly accurately. If you have something that's wildly different like this one, where the bank says that they've got $3,000, but their QuickBooks says they have $236,000, you know, this is an extreme example. But if you did see a discrepancy here, you will know, okay, maybe they're duplicating their deposits. Or maybe they're not recording all of their expenses. If there's a big differential here, then you know that something's going on. In the unaccepted column, this is how many transactions are in the bank feed waiting to be accepted. And so if the number is huge, you know that you have a backlog that you need to get caught up on in a one-time project. If there's none or there's just a couple, you know that they're keeping up with their bank feeds, and that's a good sign. The next column is how many transactions are unreconciled. And this is going to tell you one of two things. I just clicked on it, so it collapsed. It's nice to know that these sections can collapse. But you see how many transactions are unreconciled, and you also see what their reconciliation dates are. So this gives you some really good, useful information. If you see 1,500 transactions, but it hasn't been reconciled in 2 years, you're like, oh, okay, this is just a one-time cleanup where I'm going to go through, and I've got a couple years to reconcile, but once I've done that, we're up to speed and we're good. So that's the good news. The bad news you might find is if they are fairly recently reconciled, but there are hundreds of transactions that are off, this is going to tell you one of two things. Either it's telling you that they haven't been reconciling, they've been reconciling, meaning that they are matching the transactions that are on the statement, but they're not managing the transactions that were not in the statement. They were just leaving them there, which of course is going to add to this differential right here. So if you see that they were reconciled fairly recently and there's a lot of unreconciled transactions and this difference, there's a difference here, now you know you have a cleanup job to do and you should allot extra time to that initial phase of your engagement. The other piece of information it might give you instead of that is maybe this is an extremely high volume account. Maybe they do have hundreds of transactions that are going through every single month, in which case you know that you have a high volume client and you should plan for that in the number of hours that you're assigning for the week. So that's how to read the different sections in the banking activity. I can also see here if you're having trouble with your banking connection, you'll see a needs attention, and then you know that you have to go refresh the bank feed logins. Now, let's take a look at common issues. This is a great analysis tool for, again, knowing if they are doing things correctly in their QuickBooks or if you're going to have to do some training and some cleanup. What's in their undeposited funds? This says that there's 16 of them. I can go ahead and click on it, although that takes me to the undeposited funds register. And this isn't where I like to see my AR because it shows both the ins and the outs. So I'm going to head back to the overview where I just was. And instead of going into undeposited funds that way, I'm actually better off going up to the plus sign in the upper right-hand corner and then going down to bank deposit and then actually seeing what's here. So I'm seeing 16 different transactions. Let me go ahead and sort them by date. Okay, these old ones are not supposed to be here. So maybe they've got duplicate revenue because there is an actual payment that was made, but maybe they sucked in the money through the bank feed, in which case you've got duplicate income. So that's going to need some cleanup. If alternatively you're looking down at it and everything is current, it just really hasn't hit the bank yet and everything's 1 week old, maybe 2 weeks old, then you just know that you're waiting for things to cycle. But that tells you, you got to go check and see what's happening in undeposited funds. Then the next three, uncategorized asset, uncategorized income, and uncategorized expense, all of these indicate that they're using the bank feed incorrectly. So if you see transactions here, it means that when things came in the bank feed, they just clicked add without summarizing where they actually came from. Uncategorized asset is almost a guarantee that it's a balance sheet account. And so anything that you find in uncategorized asset, generally what happened here is that one of the transfers went to uncategorized asset and the other transfer happened properly. So there's an extra transfer in the system. There's two of them. And the cleanup on that is fairly easy. I just go in and I delete the one that says uncategorized. And then if the other side of it, well, I'm sorry, that puts it back on the banking feed, at which point it'll either match the already existing one that is in there, or maybe it's old and maybe it's been reconciled, in which case you can just exclude it and just make sure that they hit the register properly. But uncategorized asset is always a transfer that didn't hit on both sides in both balance sheet accounts. Uncategorized income was a deposit that they just sucked in. Anything under uncategorized expense is an expense that they didn't, again, categorize. So you'll know that you have some cleanup to do with those. And when you are doing cleanup on those, I want to make sure that everybody here is familiar with the Reclassify tool. And that is up under the accountant's briefcase. There's Reclassify. And when I go to Reclassify, I can then go in and look. I'll see uncategorized expenses down under in the expenses section, or uncategorized income up in the top part. And what the Reclassify allows you to do, I'm just going to kind of click in a random place, but you can check off transactions that were wrong and then just simply come here and assign them to the correct account down here at the bottom, say what they're really for. So what I'm asking you to do then is just to find that uncategorized income and maybe delete that transaction so that you can properly match that to a deposit in the undeposited funds. And if you see something in uncategorized expense, you can just go through and use Reclassify to move it where it belongs. While I'm here digressing in the reclassify transactions, I also want to show you another really helpful tool. If you're using reclassify and you are doing a lot of work in here and you even click on some of these transactions to open them and look at them, you've probably noticed that the dates always revert back to whatever they were before and you have to change them constantly. So I want to show you another tool also up under the briefcase, and that is reports tools down here. When I click on reports tools, there's a tool that you have as an accountant user that the business owner does not have. And out of the box, QuickBooks Online defaults to last month. So every time you open a report, it says last month. And then most of the time you have to go and change it either to year to date or this month or, you know, whatever your desired report range is. So what I do for all of my clients as a rule is come in here when I'm setting up their file and change this to whatever their preference would be. Most people choose this year to date. And then whenever you run reports, it says this year to date. The reason why I bring this up here is that if you're using Reclassify and doing a lot of work in Reclassify, maybe you're doing last year's transactions. What I like to do, I'm going to press the letter Y. The letter Y here will send me back to January 1st of 2018. So now I'm doing all of last year up until now. And then when I go into Reclassify, it's going to stay on that date range as I do all of my cleanup work here. And then once I'm done with all of the recategorization, I always go back to report tools and then reset this to this year to date. Sometimes though, because I tend to forget that I was doing this, every time I do this technique, I'll actually write down on a little sticky note the client's name and reset a report date and stick it to my monitor so that I don't forget, because otherwise I might. So here I am. Again, I wanted to show you Reclassify and report tools. Now let's go back to where we were. Go back to the overview tab again, and we were just talking about reclassifying the uncategorized income and the uncategorized expense. Just as a recap, uncategorized income, you probably want to delete those and then match them to the real sales receipts and invoice payments that were received. Uncategorized expense, you can just shunt off to all the different places. Now, let's take a look at opening balance equity. Your opening balance equity should always be zero. Opening balance equity is used when you first open up a QuickBooks Online file to hold all of the balances for all of your checking accounts, savings accounts, loans, lines of credit, credit cards as of the start date of your file. So if your start date was January 1st of this year, your opening balance equity has the whole total from each of the accounts as of December 31st of last year. I'll go ahead and click on that. And so you'll see that starting balance in there. You may also see inventory asset values that when people were putting in their products and services and their inventory, if when they set up that product, they said, oh, on this date, I had this many of these in stock and here's how much it cost me, then it's going to add that dollar amount in here as well. So after your whole file is completely set up, you should be completely good to go here. And what you want to do is when you're done, make a journal entry, and it can either be after your end date or maybe the end of the year that you had set up. But I'll go ahead and I'll put in, so I'll do 9/30/18. And then I will just do an offsetting transaction for the exact same dollar amount to total it off. And I'll put that to retained earnings. Retained earnings is the account that shows the cumulative value undistributed undistributed revenue of the company through the years cumulatively. And since the start date of this file is the first of the year, the retained earnings is everything the company had up until that date. So you zero out your opening balance equity. And then that solves that problem. And then when I go back to the overview tab, my OBE is now zero. So that part's right. Now, there's a section for negative asset and liability accounts. And what this basically means is this checking account has a negative balance. There's something really wrong with that because a checking account should always have a positive balance. So it's here because if I go and click on it, I see that I've got a problem. Their expenses are there, but their deposits are not. And if I go back to the overview tab again, there's accumulated depreciation. So something's wrong with this file because the accumulated depreciation would be positive. Excuse me. The accumulated depreciation must be positive instead of negative, or negative instead of positive, but that balance is reversed. So this overview then gives me a great way of knowing that I've got some balance sheet accounts that need attention. Last, down at the bottom is the transaction volume. And when you look here, this shows you how much activity there is in the company. So if you are going to take them on as a bookkeeping client, you want to know, is this client going to be an hour a week, or is this client going to be 10 hours a week or more or less? So there is a dropdown. You can see the activity for just the last month. You can also see it for the last quarter, because some people have more busy and slower months, or for the year, which gives a whole idea of how much to expect over the space of a year. And then that way you can see, okay, this is how many bank transactions they have. Okay, that's not that bad. Okay, this is a smallish client. But if this says 55,000, then you know that you've got a really big client. You can see how many invoices they've written. And if you click on it, it will take you to see the invoices for that year, whether they've been paid or not. It's just the total number of invoices written. And then how many bills they have written. Some clients don't do bills at all. They just go straight to expenses. Others have a lot of bills and a lot of accounts payable. And then bill payments. And then these two work really nicely together. If they have a lot of bills but not a lot of bill payments, you think to yourself, maybe they're having a cash flow problem, that they have a lot of bills but they're not paying them. So looking at that differential can be really handy too. And then, of course, all of these are hyperlinks so that you can go in and go straight to those reports. So that is the new overview tab, and you can see how handy that is for doing analysis. This is Alicia Pollack at learn.royalwise.com, and hey, look what I found.